notice requirements of the Open Public Meetings Act of the State of New Jersey have been satisfied by the inclusion of the date, time, and place of this regular meeting in the annual schedule and notice of regular meetings of this governing body. Such annual schedule and notice of regular meetings is posted at Borough Hall, was sent to the record in the Ridgewood News, posted on the Borough website, and filed with the Borough of Dumont. Councilmembers Brophy.
Here.
Carrick. Hayes. Raquel May.
Here.
Stiliano.
Here.
Zamachance.
Here.
Mayor Kelly.
Here.
I get a motion to accept the agenda as presented.
Motion to accept the agenda.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
At this time, I'd like to ask Chief Panta to come forward, and we have a special proclamation tonight, but I'd like to have him give just a brief history of what this proclamation is about.
This is my first.
Yeah.
There's somebody else in the tent tonight who's not in this town. Sarah's in the right back here in the green shirt. She's the reason why all this is taking place tonight. Back in April, I received a letter from Sarah requesting a patch for Daniel Barden, who was one of the youngsters killed in Newtown, Connecticut. Normally we get these patch requests or shirt requests all the time, but when I got hers, you know, it struck me out because obviously Newtown is something that affected the entire nation. I'm going to try not to get touched up because, you know, I went there a week after with my police department, and just being there was a surreal feeling. It was just a horrible tragedy, and being part of that town, you felt the strength. And what Sarah is doing is just, it's amazing. She's trying to bring some kind of healing to the family by collecting the patch album for Daniel, who he is fired for a firefighter. And family, I believe it was his father, his cousins that were members of the FDNY. His funeral was attended by hundreds of firefighters from all over. They never knew this kid. They came to show their support, you know, because obviously, you know, it affected everybody. So when I got her request, I decided, you know, I'm obviously going to fulfill her request. It said beside the letter, beside the patch, to send a letter. So I wasn't sure if I'd be able to write a letter to the family or not, so I said, no, I'll send her patch. I'll write a letter to her expressing my feelings about how, you know, great I thought what she was doing there was. After I finished writing that, I was in a mood to continue writing. It helped me out. So then I wrote a letter to the family as well. I sent a copy to members of the mayor and council. I sent it to Sarah, and eventually we're going to send that to, Sarah's going to send that to the family. I got input from certain guys in the department. You know, we added some things to it. It came out really nice. And on top of that, the mayor and council, Mr. Perkins, Mayor Kelly, jumped in right away. They wanted to do something to this proclamation, you know, naming Daniel Barden an honorary captain in the fire department, also naming a day after him. I believe it's tomorrow?
Yes, tomorrow.
Yes. So tomorrow is going to be honorary captain Daniel Barden Day in the borough of Dumont. So we wanted to present it in front of Mayor Council, just to put it out there. Eventually, we're going to send a copy of it to his family. So once they receive everything from Sarah, they're going to receive this as well. And it's just trying to let them know that they're not alone. You know, I'm sure they're just unimaginable. And it's acts like this that maybe will make, you know, a little bit of a day brighter for them. So, I mean, Sarah is the reason why we're all here.
Fire department, just like the members of his family in the New York City Fire Department.
Whereas Daniel was one of the 20 students and 6 faculty members who lied to tragically cut short at Sandy Hook Elementary School on December 14, 2012. His funeral was attended by more than 100 firefighters from throughout the tri-state area and beyond. And whereas after witnessing this community of Newtown's remarkable strength firsthand while visiting and delivering donations of toys during the week following the tragedy, Dumont Fire Chief Matthew Banza, in a letter to the Barton family, stated that every firefighter who has ever been through the ranks will say there is no greater job of firefighting than being the captain of a firehouse. The Chief Banza finds no one more deserving to hold the honorary position of captain to the Dumont Fire Department than Daniel Barton. Now therefore be resolved that I, James J. Kelly, Mayor of Dumont, do hereby proclaim June 19, 2013 as honorary captain Daniel Barton Day.
Actually, I have 2 copies of the proclamation. One's going to be going up to the Barton family, and one will be hung here in our hall for all to see. Motion to approve the May 21st, 2013 executive meeting, public meeting, and closed sessions.
Councilmembers Brophy?
Yes.
McKelvey?
Yes.
Stiliano?
Yes.
Zamachansky?
On Virginia, I requested and got approval from the mayor and council this evening to remove the signs, parking signs, that stipulate 7 to 7 no parking, including Saturdays. We've been getting a lot of calls relative to the hardship for some of the residents that live on the street. The intent is to keep traffic, parking traffic down because people are parking their cars there and jumping on a bus. Residents for the entire day. But 7 to 7 is moved over to an old ordinance. So I've been authorized that
of a resident, and I think this is something we've discussed already in the past, is possibly looking into either a sticker or some kind of a marking for borough residents for their cars, so that the police department knows if they're a borough resident or not. And maybe we could fashion the, you know, the signs that we made around that, so that, you know, it seems like they're doing a lot to, you know, take care of the commuter parking issue, but at the same time, it, you know, it seems like everything we do will inconvenience one or another resident, and maybe we can come up with something. This is that the police department possibly will get to. Cost-wise, because it sounds like it would be a lot for everyone to be issued a permit or some kind of a sticker. I don't know if this has been looked at in the past, but that would be a consideration for the municipal police.
Perfect.
Thank you for bringing that.
About a year or so ago, we applied for a grant in the Department of Transportation program called the Enhancement Program, which allows towns to do projects that will enhance traffic or parking or commuter traffic, and we were rejected. We were rejected by what we were able to do with this project, and they said it was a lack of funding. The project itself was a good project. They just basically ran out of money. So we will look at that in the next round. The DPW there's a few projects will be approved tonight. We will be having the construction meeting within hopefully the next few days to get that going. We want, as soon as school ends, we want to start that project, so we make sure it's done before school starts. And we were notified through the State of New Jersey Clean Communities Grant, and we received $7,793 this year. That's all I have.
Thank you, John.
Good, just one question.
Sure.
John, was there anything to bring up on the that demonstration at 6 p.m.? I was unable to attend, but I know before.
Mayor Carr?
Yeah.
Yes. Ellen, do you want to bring up your own input?
Okay.
We're looking at a capital project to do a number of things in the borough, some DPW equipment, some police department equipment. One of the things that was discussed at the last meeting when the mayor council basically authorized the capital was to include a license plate reader, which is mounted on a police car. And the police cars can be traveling in any direction, in parking lots and on normal streets, and these readers read every single plate that goes by. It's an incredible feature. Most of the towns around us have it. It was demonstrated tonight by Closter and then the representatives of the company that that makes this unit. The police department has requested it. We are considering it now in the capital. We're also looking into a grant through the Burke County Prosecutor's Office of the state to see whether or not we can get the money to fund it rather than have to go through a capital project. But if it goes by a car and the car is wanted for whatever reason, everything that has to do with the driver is associated with that license plate, it comes up as a hit on the screen, giving you a picture of the car and why it's wanted. And then the police department can make a stop, verify that the plate is in fact correct, and they can go ahead and ticket or impound or arrest, whatever. So it's something we're definitely considering. It was demonstrated tonight. A couple of members of the council were there. Police department's totally in favor, both the chief and the traffic bureau. So it looks like it's something we're going to move on, whether or not there's grant or power.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Committee reports. Councilman Brogan.
Thank you, Mayor. Just a brief item, as John touched on, we have ordinance 1460 for capital projects, and that item that he just discussed is one of the items on there, as well as some majority of it being DPW equipment. And secondly, as discussed in the executive session, we'll be introducing a ordinance for, on behalf of the Shade Tree Commission regarding a permit process that the Shade Tree president wanted to be present for, which is why it's not being presented. That's all.
Thank you. Councilmember Kelman.
The library is hosting a display for the Dumont Volunteer Ambulance Corps during the month of May and June in honor of their 75th anniversary. I'll be attending their meeting next week, June 26th. Also, I'll be attending the Ambulance Corps meeting on June 24th. And I don't have a report for the DPW. Thank you.
Any questions, Connor? Councilor Sleeney?
Thank you. I attended the last school board meeting where awards were given to each school teacher of the year. The award for the district's teacher of the year was given to Mrs. Brady, so congratulations to her. She does a phenomenal job for the kids. The board also recognized several teachers who are retiring this year, and frankly, I think I had some of them when I was in high school, so congratulations to these teachers on their retirement. The Dumont 5K committee continues to meet and plan for this year's 5K festivities, which will take place on August 31st at Dumont High School. We're hoping to build on last year's record turnout. It's always a phenomenal event, and the community really has come out to support us. I want to thank all of our sponsors. The sponsorships have been rolling in. And the latest sponsors were Borough Attorney Greg Pastor, our Borough Administrator John Perkins. I want to thank both of you. And Councilman Brophy, who tonight gave us a check for $300. Thank you, Councilman Brophy. And Councilman Brophy's son, for those of you who don't know, is due to be born on August 29th, and he's already signed him up to run the 5K 2 days later. I'd like to thank, really, from the bottom of my heart, my co-chairs, Raphael and Ellen, who have gone above and beyond in helping to get this event planned. And if anybody wants to help us, just give me a call or seek me out, and we're happy to have all the help we can get. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilwoman Zemchansky?
Thank you. Recreation sign-ups for camp have been extended. There is a late fee, but the people can still sign up. The rec department has hired Janet Galligan for Monday, Tuesday, and Friday for 3 hours, each of those 3 days, just for a short period right now to screen calls up there. Health department meeting last week, unfortunately I missed due to a family emergency, but they are reviewing the health ordinances. I guess they're having some issues with some of the things, and then we're going to set up a meeting. They only meet quarterly, so we're going to have to set up a meeting and see what the issues are with that. One person stepped down, we've got two new members. Fire department for the month of May had a total of 31 alarms, which made 139 for the year, 778 man hours, which made a total of 3,000 for the year, and Dumont sign-ups are going well. That's it.
Okay, thank you. this time of year, we have all of our students, or not all of our students, but many of our students graduating from either grammar school, high school. I'd like just to extend my congratulations as well as the members of the council to all those students. I attended the awards dinner for the high school. Very proud moment for the parents as well as all the athletes. And at that time of year, we're all going to be a graduation party sometime in the next month or so. So I'd just like to extend the congratulations out to them. Could I start the consent agenda items?
All items with an asterisk are considered to be non-controversial by the council and will be approved by one motion. There may be further discussion prior to the vote upon request of a member of the public or a council member. Also, any item may be removed for further discussion or for roll call vote, in which case the item will be removed and considered in its normal sequence as part of the general order of business. Number 118, approval of block party on Walcott Road, August 10th. 119, approval of liquor license renewals. 120, approval of taxi and limousine permit renewals. 121, approval of coin machine permit renewals. Number 122, bills list. 123, Monica Chilarca, approval of hiring as construction central clerk, $25,000 annually. 124, 2013 salary resolution amendment. 125, award of bid to J.J. Sinisi, Inc. for the Q Street 1 road project. $118,610.98. 126, authorization of agreement with Signal Outdoor Advertising. 127, approval of Elks Lodge number 2593 off-premise cash raffle to be held October 12, 2013. 128, Anthony Spadaro, accept application as firefighter. Number 129, Andrew Bluckman, accept application as auxiliary firefighter. Number 130, Christopher Hargrave, accept application as auxiliary firefighter. Number 131, authorization to sell 1998 Ford van to DeMauro Towing for scrap, $100. 132, approval of block party, Dakota Avenue, July 6th. Number 133, approval of 2012 ambulance corps LOSAP contribution, $9,000. Number 134, approval of family fund off-premise cash raffle to be held September 16, 2013.
Thank you. Do we have any comments or questions from members of the council on these consent agenda items? Seeing none, can I get a motion to open to the public on just the consent agenda only?
Motion. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
At this moment, if anyone from the public has any comments or questions only on the consent agenda items, please step to the microphone, state your name and address for the record. Sir.
Hi, Chairman. First question is on number 122 bill sets. I'd like to know what was purchased with check 52869, check date June 7th, the Dark Computer Services for $7,200.
Mr. Chen, I don't know what that is. I'll have to look at it. I don't have that specified.
Okay.
I can find out later.
Can you email me?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. My second question is on the 123 and 124, the appointment of a new construction center clerk.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a new title or is it a replacement title?
We had a Rosie from the building department resign, so it's replacing her. She's basically doing it on a part-time basis.
No, she's still going to do it full-time. Okay, but the title, is it a new title in the borough or is it a
construction center? I believe it's the same title.
Okay. Now I have ordinance 1445 from 2012, and I don't seem to find that title in the ordinance to be able to locate.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
You said it's 1445, 2012?
Yeah, I have a copy of it.
So your question is, what is the...
My question is, first, whether it's an existing title or it's a new title. And if it's a new title, then why was it not on the list? And if it's a new title, then what is the... why is there a new title and why is it being...
It should be on the order.
Right.
It should be salary
right.
Range for that.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
My understanding is it's not a new title. And she's just a replacement of an existing spot.
Okay, so I'd like to find out where that title is. Look back on that situation.
All right, I'll email.
Okay.
What's it back?
Thank you, sir. Do you have any more? Excuse me?
This is one.
Do you have a question? If you stand up and
no, no, no.
Okay. Any members from the audience have any questions on the consent agenda items? Seeing none, can I get a motion to close?
Motion to close.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Can I get a motion to accept the items on the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Council members Brophy?
Yes.
McCallum?
Yes.
Stiliana?
Yes.
Town Chancellor?
Yes.
at this point, could I get a motion to open to the public for any general comments or questions?
So moved.
Second.
At this time, if anyone from the audience has any comments or questions for the mayor and council, please step up to the microphone, state your name and address for the record.
My name is Francis Giudano, 63 Sherwood Road in town. I have to say, first of all, the issue that I bring to the table before you tonight seems very petty after listening to the opening of Newtown tragedy. However, this is an issue that has affected me tremendously as a homeowner and a taxpayer. 27 years ago, when I purchased my home, I purchased what I thought was in a very residential area. I do want to say that I've never done this before. So it's very nerve-wracking. This is not me to talk to a bunch of strangers about something very personal and that has affected me. I would prefer not with the microphone. Is that okay?
You're
right. Okay, I think everybody can hear me. 27 years ago, I purchased my home on Sherwood Road. I purchased a home that I didn't think I was going to be here 27 years later. However, I still am. Some 10 years ago, I could be off by time frame, the people next door to me sold their home, and it had come to my attention that because the state got involved, they sold it to a group home. And I have no problems with what they house there, but I do have a problem with the employees. And it has made my life miserable. I've lost my privacy. First, I'd like to say the other councilmen that, and I don't even know you, Mayor Kelly and Mr. Perkins are aware of the situation, are you not?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I believe that I brought this to Mr. Perkins' attention last year. And you did say to me we would get back, that you thought there would be a resolution. I'm here tonight, a year later, and there is still no resolution. I did contact Mayor Kelly because I felt I wasn't getting anywhere going that way. Mayor Kelly did reach back out to me 2 weeks ago, and we said we would make contact, and hopefully we would come to some resolution that would give me my privacy back. I want my privacy back at 63 Sherwood Road, okay? I've contacted the group home that has purchased this home. I'm asking for a fence. I'm not asking for $1 million. I'm asking for a fence. A fence that would separate them from me and protect me with my safety. What I say about safety is the employees have a tough time holding on to the residents. I will be in my backyard, and it will be in my backyard, okay? That's not the way I want to live. I am a widow of 7 years, and I've also been diagnosed with lung cancer. So I am now disabled, and I try to take care of everything that a homeowner should take care of, and I think I do a very good job. But we have an issue of time delay. And I don't have time because I do have to repay for that with my driveway. And in order to do that, the fence needs to be put up first. And I feel I'm getting the runaround. Not only from the group home, I also feel I'm getting the runaround here. Mayor Kelly did call me today, and he left me a message on my machine that, unless I'm, you can correct me if I'm wrong, that it would probably be no resolution would not be for a few weeks inside. Is that correct?
I said I did not know.
You did not know. Okay. As a homeowner and a taxpayer, I'm expected to do certain things as a homeowner. If my grass was to grow 6 feet high, I would be fine as a homeowner, would I not? He's shaking his head yes. Okay. The residents, the group home that lives next to me, are they see that to be a major, this is a no-brainer.
This is the first time hearing of this, so I just have a few questions.
Sure, absolutely. I'm okay now, but I am a hyper person.
No, but...
I really didn't want to have to do this tonight, because Mayor Kelly has been wonderful to me. There was a fundraiser, I want to go back. There was a fundraiser given to me after I was diagnosed, because during my chemotherapy, my radiation, my boss decided to terminate me, so I lost my job. So my friends decided to give me a fundraiser so I can carry my medical insurance. And Mayor Kelly was nice enough, and the Knights of Columbus was nice enough to donate their hall, and Mayor Kelly did all the working. I will always be forever grateful for that. And so I don't want to be a problem child in the town of Dumont. I do plan on staying here because, A, the resale on the economy is not where I want it to be. I've done a lot of work on my home. But I need my privacy back before I go crazy. It's like a Macy's parking lot. It's changes shifts, conflict. I have a sensor light in the back of my garage for my protection when it goes off. Somebody's trying to gain entrance to my house, they will wake me. They're smoking cigarettes in the back. The fence is not going to stop that. The sensor will stay, the fence is not going to stop that. I do have a swimming pool. I'm a single woman. I have strangers that are employees changing shifts walking at me. It's not the way I want to live in the town. They're spitting at my car, this is just not where to live. It's just, I don't need the stress right now. So now, when she said a wood fence, I said, this is not acceptable, a wood fence, okay? Well, that's within our budget. So, and there's one other issue I need to discuss, because, you know, if he said, she said, we said, we're going back and forth. By the time we play phone here, and this man has to be bothered with it, or Mr. Perkins has to be bothered with it, it's their responsibility. I don't care how many slices or dice this, but it's their responsibility. I didn't ask for this. I don't know if any of you could answer this, but how does this come into such a beautiful residential area, such as Sherwood Road? How is it that the state allows it? This was not your administration when it came in. It was under the other administration, okay? You don't have to notify any neighbors?
Right, it's not a change of use, and if they don't need any variances from the building code, then really, it's like anybody else can legally.
Okay. But it's, you know, let's call the spade a spade. It's not like anybody else moving in. This.
In the eyes of the law, it's a residential use,
okay.
And if they're not asking to build bigger or less green space closer to the property line, then there's no regulatory restrictions on it.
The records will indicate going way back. They have two car driveway. They have meetings here. Their staff comes in, there's meetings, there's people all over the place. I feel like I live in the Macy's parking lot, to be honest with you, and it's very disturbing to me. Under the other administration, no names mentioned, but I called the borough administrator, and he came over and took a look at it, because what happens, I have dozens of blocks that were put in by a very good contractor, very expensive. Now this man can't make the turn, so instead of trying to make the turn, they choose to go over my 1,000 blocks. To me, the last time I looked it up, it's the face of my property, okay? That's the face of my property, when you start to disturb my property. The administration before you, they were able, a wider driveway has been put in. It's still not helping, because they want to do whatever they want to do. They want to park wherever they want to park. When the vans come to pick up the residents for their workshop, they can't pull into their driveway. They got to pull in the driveway. None of this is making any sense to me. And if I don't stop it somehow, this is going to continue. And it's not a healthy situation. So I'm not going to go for a wooden fence. I want a vinyl 6 foot put up, we're talking 405 square feet going this way, I believe. And then the fence here where it can be locked, that from my side, that nobody can get in. And I think that's to protect me as a homeowner and a taxpayer. So in any event, that I'm asking you to consider passing a resolution to reimburse me the difference in cost between a wood fence with maintenance, which I cannot do. I cannot maintain this fence. It's a wood fence. We have to wait a year, then it has to be whatever, coated, whatever, I'm not familiar with it. A vinyl fence, I could hose it down from my side. And this is a no-brainer. Unless we can get them to do a vinyl fence.
Sure, yeah. You were right before we've gone on probably maybe more than a year.
Yeah, I wasn't sure, so.
Yeah, and there's the initial issues before the fence issue came up was the parking by staff and the inability for you to pull in that new driveway without, you know, have to shovel your car up. And we met a number of times on site with staff and tried to have that corrected. I know sometimes it was corrected, and I'm sure
it sounds better.
Okay, sometimes it was bad. With regards to the fence, you and I started talking about that. I think Linda Blakely's her name, the manager there.
Linda, I don't know her last name.
Dave Blakely. I have made numerous requests to the building department, who has regular contact with this try and set up a meeting. Little did I know until I finally told her, well, she was at home, and it's been on medical leave, I don't know for a long time.
She broke her ankle.
She finally called me, and we talked about the fence. She called me last week about whether or not they needed a permit to go from 4 foot to 6 foot. She didn't say anything about what type of fence was going to be. But I gotta tell you, normally, when there's an issue between two property owners, have them get followed. I mean, we've done this, and we've made numerous contacts for your benefit to try and get this resolved. But if it was someone other than the issue that you were having, the fact that you know, you had mentioned about the fact that you were sick, we decided to try and take this on and try and make contact with them. It was normally between two residents. And this borough, but the mayor council or any department in the borough would be involved unless we got an issue permit.
And trust me, I like to take care of my own situations. I don't like to get anybody involved. Whatever I need to do, I get it done. I get the job done by me. But we're not talking homeowner to homeowner. I have a homeowner on the other side. You know, if her rose garden is over on mine, she says to me, I'm going to come back from over to your property and prune it. We all work together. And I'm the most affected by it. This is, I don't want to be smelling the fumes from their van in and out all day long. This is just not a normal situation.
That's not my issue.
I understand what you're saying, and I didn't want to get you involved. But there's no other recourse. I mean, they're not paying taxes. This is a group home in a residential area. And like I said, and I don't mean to be argumentative and disrespect in any recourse whatsoever, but this is not what I bought 27 years ago. Do I have an option to move? Can any of you say to me, well, if you're not happy, Mr. G. Dow, you can move? No, I can't. I'm disabled. Nobody's going to give me another mortgage.
I don't think you're going to say it.
Okay, no, I'm just saying. I like to get ahead of myself. I'm very verbal and I'm very expressive. And I just, the situation is, I open my side door and I see a whole bunch of going on. You know, I won't see that with the fence there. I want, and I go in the backyard. I have the employees walking at me. I don't know who belongs here or not. I could very well think that that's an employee. And what happens if it's not an employee?
Okay, which they're willing to do.
Well, here's what she said, though. She told me today, and I asked her, could I quote her, and she said yes. She said she didn't know, the contractor didn't know if they needed a permit. Every good contractor knows you need a permit, okay? I'm going to do the back of the driveway. I need a permit. Two, she said to me that she's called here since last week, and nobody has returned her phone call.
Oh, that's not true. She's called me last Thursday.
So now I'm wondering, am I getting the runaround here, or am I getting the runaround here? She said that she mentioned you. She said, I've been reaching out to Mr. Perkins since last week, and he hasn't returned any of my phone calls.
There are no messages from her. At the time that I called, she said, do I need a permit? My answer to her was yes to do. I actually transferred her up to Steve's office.
She told me today that she has called. I have to tell you again. She told me today that she's been calling and calling. Nobody's returning her phone calls. They cannot proceed with the fence because nobody from here is calling her back regarding a permit, okay, and what needs to be done. I said to her, are you sure about that? She said, yes, because I'm going to quote you. I'm going to a meeting tonight.
Does she have a contractor? You said
she said a new family. She has a contractor.
Has the contractor come into the borough or the building department and applied to her applicant?
Very simple. Yeah. I told her that. Because I have, I don't know how to pronounce it, but they're a very well-known painting company. Shishola, painting company. Who is it? They were going to go back on my driveway. He gave me their insurance today. They gave me everything. He said, you might need to survey for them. He said, very smart. because the fence has to go up first. They have to lift my concrete, put the gravel down, and then wait 2 weeks before they can asphalt and butt up against it.
Now, did her this, you know, I know she said she was out with some kind of ankle fracture.
She's back.
Or did that prevent her, because I spoke to her.
No, she's working from home.
All right, so does that prevent her, did that prevent her from coming, you know, probably half a mile?
I guess it did.
Okay.
I guess it did. I don't believe, she's not here on property, Dumont, North End. So North End is to Linda. She has been very nice. I don't want to do her by saying she hasn't, but she's not doing anything. If I don't follow up.
Then interesting.
Exactly. And I said to her today, and I was very, I have to at this point, I said, Linda, I'm gonna tell you, you can storm me all you want, this is not going away. The only way it's gonna go away is if I pass away. And then my children will get my home, they'll put it up for sale, and it will be done, okay? So I feel I'm being stalled. Now we're gonna have an issue with the wooden fence versus a fine fence. So I had to think quick, and I said to her, okay, excluding the labor, have your man draw up a proposal for a wooden fence and a vinyl fence. And then, because I'm asking you guys to consider a resolution to pick up the victims, if it should have to go that way. I cannot afford to pay the difference. I did ask her why a wooden fence, because it needs to be maintained. We're being paid foolish here down the road. Okay, let's get more bang for your buck. Because a wood fence needs to be treated. A vinyl has no maintenance. I can't get out there and take care of it because the good side's going to be on my side.
Yes, the one thing is that the town of Dumont cannot, we cannot go on private property and form a resolution that will give you money to take care of your property, because then this place will be filled with people asking me to give them money to take care of their homes. What we will do, and we, you know, we're trying to do, is to work on your behalf with the Spectrum for Living, which are the people that own.
I know you have. I know you have.
And we'll be willing to ask them to consider a vinyl fence, but we can't go and tell them they have to put in a vinyl fence, and you know, we have no legal right to do that. As our attorney
said. So the next suggestion I thought in my head, okay, well then, you know, discount my taxes for the difference. Of course, that can't be done either. I understand that, okay? I'm a research person, so I know what can be done and what can't be done in the borough. So then the next thing would be to reimburse me the difference should I have to put it out. I can't maintain that wood fence if it's rotted out. If I do get to live, if I'm lucky enough to live another 20 years, which I hope, okay, this fence needs to be taken care of. They're not going to take care of it. They're not going to take care of it on my side. So, but they have to spend, because I said to her, who is going to maintain my side of the fence? She said, my contractor. I said, oh no, I'm not just a single contractor. I'm not going to go through this next year, and if something goes wrong with it, no, I'm not going to do that. But let's try to resolve it now and resolve it in a timely fashion, and like Mr. Perkins is correct, we're going back for, this is over a year now.
What we will do, what we can do is, again, we can't really intercede and tell them what they have to do. I've been involved actually with the Spectrum for Living for many years. I know people, one woman that ran it for many years. I think it's a great thing, and I'd be willing to find out some people there that can help you get your resolutions, you know, to your particular problem, and we'll do that, but I can't guarantee you anything. I think Linda seems pretty reasonable for the most part. So we'll continue to work on your behalf.
But she said that she didn't get any return phone calls.
I spoke with her, I don't know how many times, there's no messages on my phone that we throw on
the
phone.
She said to me, she said, well, I'm waiting for them to tell me if I need, this was today. Your eyes are popping out because.
I told her she needed a permit, I transferred her.
And like Mr. Howard said, this is a no-brainer. Any work that you do on your property, you need a permit. I mean, I'm sure people are doing work on the property without a permit. I'm sure they are. They can get a because of this.
All right, what we'll do is, we will reach out to Linda tomorrow and at least have a conversation with her and try to get a feel for what she's able to do. Like, they obviously have budgets as well, and she told you that, you know, that was the case. You may be right, I don't know what the difference between a wooden fence and a vinyl fence is.
I believe a vinyl fence is probably more expensive.
I would imagine that.
I believe it, it is more expensive. So that's why I did propose to her, just so there's a resolution, I want to be done with it. I said to her, I think we're up, but I do want to see, I want to see the proposal.
We'll ask her to have the contractor come in to get the permit. When he comes in for the permit, he'll show us the plans of what he intends to build, and then we'll be able to tell you what they're doing. I mean, that should be information you'll be able to have anyway, once they submit for the permits. And we'll...
Do we need to go? I put my survey out tonight, because she said to me, well, what else do I need? I said, I think you're going to need a survey, because there is an existing bench right there. So we need to all be on the money here that this is being done properly.
That I will rely on my building department to do that, because I don't know the particulars of that. But we'll reach out to her and see what she says. Again, there's not a lot of promises I can make to you tonight, but...
I do apologize for taking up your time, because this is really petty. No, it's really petty. There's a lot more going on in this world that needs a lot more attention than this. But if I don't protect my own, nobody's going to protect it for me.
That's understood. Okay, I just have one question to make sure I understood you, or heard you correctly. You say you have a 4-foot fence around your perimeter now, and the residents of this group home still find their way onto your property, mm-hmm. and you have a swimming pool.
Yes.
And that's also a potential welfare issue of the residents having constantly sufficient care.
I understand that,
but they got past your fence and into your property, right? So
yeah.
Now they're possibly exposed to a pool. And,
yes.
Yeah.
Also, my pool, I mean, they can climb on the pool itself.
Mm-hmm.
I do have the deck.
Yep.
And I put the ladder up.
Yeah.
But still, anybody
that's
can jump over the fence that way.
Why are they getting onto your property? Is just a general question. You know,
if you live on
a busy road, why would they be getting onto a busy road?
Well, what happens, you know, they get off the Spectrum bus,
mm-hmm.
They go to workshop, and when they get off, they get away from their gates.
But they shouldn't, is the point.
Shouldn't, couldn't, mm-hmm. you know what, I know that, I'm aware of that.
I mean, is there not enough aids, is the question, it's just a separate point.
You know what, truthfully, Mr. Bill, that's not my, I understand exactly what you're saying.
Yep.
Don't want them on
there. Well, you're sure I heard you correctly.
Yeah, you did. So they are getting on there. Okay, so I trust that you will, but I'm just asking you, please, I don't want to be doing this July, August, September. I want to be doing it. I want to do it yesterday. I want to be done with it. I want to move on. Okay, the bigger and better thing. I do have one other issue, which she was very taken back by, which I don't understand. Again, it has to do with them. The maintenance of their, I don't know whose responsibility is what anymore, okay? But I know if something is of mine, is going to my next door neighbor on the other side, I clean it up. It's my responsibility. They had a choice. I just had brand new vinyl siding and put on my garage, okay? They had a tree, and I didn't notice it over here. It was when I went to the back of the garage. I saw their tree in the back of my garage. I can't do the landscaping, so now I have the landscaper that's on the block, and they have them too. So when he came, I said to him, that tree's got to be removed. That tree's not mine. He said, I can't do it without permission. I got Linda on the phone. He spoke with Linda. The tree was removed, so I have to give Linda that. She had a choice of putting it back or removing it. But he said the tree is a very pretty, dangerous tree. It is on Mrs. Giovanni's property. If somebody gets hurt, they're going to get hurt. And she has grandchildren, which I know. So if my grandchildren get hurt because of that tree, then there's a liability. So the tree was removed. I went out there, and my vinyl siding in the back, I took pictures, I didn't bring the camera with me, so you need to see them, you can. All green and green. My vinyl siding is beautiful. The guy that did it said, you never have to power wash this. It's no meaning. Called Linda, and I said, I went out there with a hose. I'm on one lung. I went out there with a hose. I hosed it down. I scrubbed until I was out of breath. I threw the hose down. I threw the brush down. I said, this is not my job. It was their tree that leaned on my vinyl siding and grew in my back of my garage. So now I've got green all on the left side and green in the back. Can anybody tell me whose responsibility that is to pay for the power washing?
Greg, isn't when the branches go over to a neighbor's property, isn't the tree the responsibility of the homeowner?
The general rule in those where a tree falls is everybody's responsible for their own side of the property line. Whoever's house, whosever property the roots are in, is responsible for removal of the tree, but the result is sort of, you deal with your own result.
The roots are on their property.
Right, so they're responsible for removing the tree, which it sounds like you did, but whatever the result is, generally speaking, as an insurance matter and as a legal matter, whatever the result is, because you can't really plan for it, everybody sort of left to their own. That's generally the rule. It's not in all cases, but that's the way it works out.
Well, fair or not fair, I have to say that's unfair. Because if that tree didn't leak, if they would have took care of it, the people that are taking care of the residents, if they would have noticed, or the landscaper would have noticed, that tree would have been leaning, that would have grown. Somebody would have maintained it, took a good look of what was growing. It would have never grew in the back of my garage.
Yeah, I was going to say, you probably could contact your insurance or...
It didn't damage my vinyl siding. It's all green. I can't do it. If my husband was alive, or I was well enough to do it, I would do it. But I don't have anybody to do it.
You might be able to put in an insurance claim for the cleanup. I mean, that could be considered, damage from the neighboring tree. I mean, in Sandy, I can tell you...
So you're not responsible? So if the tree fell on my, if their tree, let's say their tree fell on, okay, let me do it this way. I have a town tree on my front lawn. The wind comes, or we go through another October. That tree falls on my house and damages my home. The town is exempt from all liability and falls under my homeowner's insurance?
Your insurance company.
Yeah, the town is in a different legal circumstance, but the town would be responsible for moving the tree, and then your insurance would pay it down. That's generally the way it
works. I'm sorry?
The insurance, I'm sorry.
Your insurance covers your property. So if your neighbor's tree fell in your house, your insurance company would pay for that.
And if it was their fault for some reason, if there was some negligence involved.
Well, I believe that's where I think I was going.
But then that would be a matter of...
I think it was negligence. What I think I'd like to do then, from so we can move forward, they need to really keep... They have nobody from corporate checking the property. I think they need to make sure that once we get the fence issue all rectified, okay, and we can all move forward, I think they need to be told, because there's a lot of people living there, okay? I don't smoke. I got cancer because I smoke. I don't need the butts in my driveway. They need to clean up. They need to be aware of what is transpiring on their property.
Do you let them know these things?
I do, but it's falling on deaf ears, because here's the truth of the matter. Okay, and I'm going to call a spade here. I live there. That's my pride and joy for 27 years. I care about what happens on Sherwood Road, because I live there. It's a reflection of me, too. It's when people pull up and they see the beautiful street that we do live on. Their employees, they're getting a paycheck at the end of the week. I'm not getting a paycheck to live there. I'm paying to live there. I'm paying to the town of Dumont, taxes, and I'm paying my mortgage to live there. They're not. At the end of the day, they go home, and they don't, and that's it. They're on their breath, they're giving me choice words, and it's, you know, we need to work together, we need to come together. I will tell you, the new manager that is one of the aides during the day, her name is Lisa. She's a lovely girl. She sees everything that's going on. She's new. She's starting to see, she sees that. She called me, she said, the woman is like, things are, you know, need to be taken care of around here. You know, everything is a budget. I understand, everything is a budget.
But that's the proper channels to go. We will help you in any way that we can. But it's an issue with Spectrum that, you know, that they need to tell you why these things are happening or why they're not happening and what they're doing to resolve them. And we will, because you brought this to our attention,
okay,
we will reach out to them and let them know the complaints that you have. You've already told them, so they obviously know these complaints. And we'll ask them, what are you doing to resolve these things? You know, are these legitimate issues, and what are you doing to resolve them? That's what we can do for you. And we will stay, you know, we'll help you with the fence thing, but again, it's also, it's a private property issue where the town can only get so involved and can only do so many things. But we've already shown that we're trying to help you out.
I know that. And that's why.
We continue to do that.
Okay. I think what made me come is at 2 o'clock when she said to me today, well, I don't know what to tell you because it's your town and they're not returning phone calls. And I want to know if I have to get a permit. I said to her, Linda, if you have a good contractor, he would know. Your contractor would know.
I think
my grandson is 2 years old, he would know. You know, I mean, facetious at that point. I said, I am sure that she says she called Mr. Perkins, she called the building department.
They issued a permit, so she would need to talk with them or have a contract to go to them.
She said she started this last week and nobody was concerned to meet her phone calls.
I talked with her. I'm not going to get into it yet.
Yeah. All right, so, yeah.
I'll get into it tomorrow.
Okay. Please, and you can tell her that I said it, because I said to her, I'm going to quote you. You're sure that he called Mr. Perkins and he didn't return your phone? You're sure? She said, I'm absolutely sure. I said, I'll tell you what. I'm going to call there today myself, but then I think I returned your phone call and you were at work or whatever. So, all right. Please, I just ask you, do the best that you can. And
we will.
The wood fence, if you can.
Well, again, we'll talk to her and you know, let her know that you're not happy with that situation. Again, we can't tell that you have to do a vinyl fence.
But do I need, like, I have to let my painting guy know. Am I going to know when this is all happening? I mean, they have to come and take my whole fence down. That is my fence.
Well, we'll know through the permit.
Like, how are they going to know all this?
Do the work. So once the guy comes up with the permit, we'll know when that work's going to be done.
Okay, I just would like an easy, a very easy transition. So. Okay, thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Keller.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Well, I came here for one reason. Now I'm going to get here for two. Robert McDonald, 75 Lucille Avenue in Greenwood. I came here because in many occasions, as we saw tonight, people come with problems. I actually came to thank the building department with Steve Cavadidis, Mayor Kelly, and John Perkins, because I had a serious problem with my neighbor. It was like living next to a jungle. Okay, I had grass that was this high. I had garbage in front of the house like it was, we were in, you know, Harlem. Okay. I reached out to Steve Cavadidis. He started the process rolling. I'm going to embarrass him, but I called the mayor on the Saturday of Memorial Day weekend. He was going out of town. He didn't get back to me on Saturday, and I said, well, okay, it's Memorial Day weekend. They'll get back to me on Tuesday. Well, much to my surprise, Mayor Kelly calls me on Sunday. of Memorial Day weekend. The first thing out of his mouth was, the first thing out of his mouth is, I'm sorry for not getting back to you. And I said, okay. Monday comes, the Memorial Day, he's in the parade. He stops, comes up to me, and again, personally apologizes for not getting back to me. So now I reach out to John Perkins. Well, anybody knows John Perkins, you reach out to him, and he says he's going to take care of it. It gets done. Okay? I'd just like to report to the council that the grass has been cut, the garbage has now all been removed, and it almost looks like a normal house. So I would personally like to thank John, and if he was here, I'd thank him. Mayor Kelly went above and beyond what he's supposed to do. So, thank you. Okay? So the matter has been 99% resolved. Now when people walk by and they look at the property and they say, wow, this is all nice. Now, the second issue was this young lady's comments about a group home. I have to disagree, and Mr. Pastor being the attorney, he may tell me I'm wrong. A group home is not like your normal neighbor. Okay? A group home is a business. So therefore, it's not like having Bill Brophy living next to me and John Perkins living on the other side. This is a legitimate business. Okay? So therefore, the rules are got to be different. Because this is a business. Just like you have a group home on Madison Avenue and Crescent. Okay? It's the same deal, guys. It's not, you know, joke your citizen living next door. Because if this group home had their grass as high as my neighbors did, you're telling me that the people who have helped me get the grass cut wouldn't go to the group home and say, hey, we have a borough ordinance that says the grass can only be so high. Okay? I overheard the young lady saying that the vehicles are parking in the driveway. You know what? Shame on you. Pick up the phone, like 10,000 other people doing this year in this town, call the cops, say, I have an illegal vehicle parked in my driveway. They're going to send a cop there?
I tried to do it with
but,
my
okay, but what I'm trying to say to you is, a group home is completely different than your neighbor. Okay? So it shouldn't have anything to do with art. Okay? And I have the utmost respect to you. But when you sat there and said it, that we can't tell them what you can do and what you can't do, it's a business. So if it's a business, then they have to abide by different rules than all of us who are just residents. And granted, they may be tax exempt. I'm not sure.
They are.
Okay, which is fine. I don't have a problem with it. If they put a group home next to my house, I'd probably be better than what I have now. But it's a whole, you guys gotta look into this. It's a whole different game. It's a whole different set of rules. So
we are looking at the situation. A group home, as much as you say it is a business, they do live by different rules, but the point we're trying to get across was the problem exists between that group home and Steer Down.
I understand. And I can, you know, I'm quite sure between the two people sitting on both sides of you, they're going to come back and they're going to say, okay, this is what we can do, and this is what we can't do. Okay? And as far as the tree, okay, the homeowner is responsible for the maintenance of the tree on their property.
And if it's like...
So that tree that's on their home, on their property, okay, does damage to my house or hers or her house, yeah, great, pick up the phone and call the insurance company. And problem is that most of us have a $500 deductible on our homeowner's insurance. So how are we going to afford? So even if the group home says, you know what, we're really sorry, we're gonna clean up the tree and we're gonna clean up the mess and all that, she's still $500 in a hole. That's not right.
It's not right, but I don't have an answer to that.
I understand.
How many of the residents come with very similar problems?
Yeah, but can I say something? I want to thank you very much. I'm not interested in anybody else. I do what I'm supposed to do as a homeowner. I maintain my property as if I had a husband living with me. I take care of my property better than a lot of people do. I got a letter from the town about a rat infestation on Sherwood Road that the town wanted everybody to put the covers on their garbage. I was the only one that did it. Why doesn't anybody else comply? The people next to me, the group home again, which was a very big issue, garbage on top of garbage on top of pouring out. Where do you think those rats came from? They didn't come from my home, they came from that home.
Okay, well,
let's just have one more question.
Make sure that the receptacles are within compliance and that they're not all over the place.
But I just have one more quick question. When the group home, before the group home moved in,
10 years,
didn't they have to put an application in to the borough? So, if the borough, well, obviously, probably none of the council were part of the routine back then. But I'm quite sure that if this group home has put an application in, somebody along the line, and doesn't the group home have to be inspected?
I'll be honest.
That's done at the state level, at the Department of Community Affairs. And as far as the application, they only need to apply for a certificate of occupancy since it's still residential use.
Right.
And it may be a business, but there's people living there. It's not like they're operating a store or whatever. They didn't need any kind of special permission. They didn't have to go before at that point, it would have been the zoning board for any kind of permission to do anything because they weren't changing the footprint of the property. They weren't moving anything closer.
Well, no, they were changing the use of property.
It's still residential, and as far as the law...
It's only residential that they're living. They're not living there.
They are living there.
I apologize. Because a lot of group homes are only, like Sunshine and Barberfield, it's in and out.
It's not a day, no, it's not a day care center. It's
okay.
It's a residential facility.
Okay.
You are aware that they don't have to lock... You are aware that one of them doesn't get locked. Thank you, sir. You are aware that that front door doesn't get locked. Are you aware of that?
I'm not aware. I don't know all the regulations behind a group home. I'll find them out now because...
But I don't understand how... We can only speak of the borough of Dumont because that's where I reside. I don't reside in Dumont or Burnville, Atlanta, so I'm not going to talk about it, rules and regulations. But that door is open. It's unlocked 24/7. What's to stop any of them? You know how many times I've had them at my storm door? I don't understand where I'm getting protected as a taxpayer. That's what I'm having a very big issue with, that nobody has to let anybody know. You can open up a group home in any town for drug rehabilitation for people that are on drugs.
There are actually several, not drug rehab, but there are other homes in Dumont that are spectrum or housing for handicapped children or adults.
Please don't get me wrong. I could have had, thank God, ADHD, autistic children, Down syndrome, bipolar. I'm a very lucky parent. I have two healthy children, okay? My resentment here is not what they house. The resentment is that I don't know how the state of New Jersey allows that to be. You put that in a different area. Put it And they're getting a paycheck, and he is right. This is not a residential. They reside there, but the people at the end of the day are getting a paycheck. They're getting a paycheck. They are tax exempt. They're getting funded by the state of New Jersey. So I'm asking for a 6-foot vinyl fence when they're getting funded? Who's funding me? Do you want to fund me?
All right, well, like I said, we'll do what we can to help you out.
Okay, because I'm going to tell you, it's not going away.
All right, but I think your problem doesn't reside here with Dumont. Your problem is the whole spectrum of, you know, of these living, spectrum for living places,
yes,
or other.
I understand that.
We can't control it. We can only control what we can that they do.
But I am asking you to intervene somehow because...
We will look to make sure they're doing everything that they can do, that they're supposed to do.
They can care less. They can care less. She's a worker for that Lutheran church. So, all right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Open to public.
take a motion to close.
Motion to close.
All in favor?
Aye.
Take a motion to adopt on the second reading.
Second.
Councilmembers Broken?
Yes.
McCallum?
Yes.
Filiano?
Yes.
Namchansky?
Yes.
Ordinance number 1457, an ordinance amending and supplementing chapter 209, section 21 of the Borough of Dumont, schedule of fees and tax collector. Take a motion to waive the formal reading.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any discussion? Seeing none, take a motion open to public.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
If anyone from the public has any comments or questions on ordinance 1457, seeing none, take a motion to close to public.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Take a motion to adopt on the second reading.
Motion.
In a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilmembers Broken?
Yes.
McCallum?
Yes.
Filiano?
Yes.
Namchansky?
Yes.
Need a motion to adjourn?
No.
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 Wasn't jerk, no.
See the second page. Number 1458, ordinance to revise and amend chapter 75, section 2, police table of organization. And a motion to waive the formal reading.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any discussion? Seeing, take a motion to pass on the first reading.
Second.
Roll call.
Councilmembers Broken?
Yes.
McCallum?
Yes.
Filiano?
Yes.
Namchansky?
Yes.
And number 1459, we have a table for next, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, the capital for this, right, okay. 1459 is the table. Number 1460, bond ordinance providing for various 2013 capital improvements by the Borough of Dumont and the County of Bergen, State of New Jersey, appropriating $564,627 therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $537,690 bonds or notes of the borough to finance part of the cost thereof. Take a motion to waive the formal reading.
Motion to waive reading.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any discussion from the council? And take a motion to pass on the first reading.
So moved.
Second.
Councilmembers Broken?
Yes.
McCallum?
Yes.
Filiano?
Yes.
Namchansky?
Yes.
Motion to adjourn.
So moved.